Congratulations. You found the Twin Cities hit show.
Very well. Where do I begin?
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention?
Uh-oh. Guess what day it is.
Reach for this one.
And now, a real hit show.
It's hump day.
Hump day!
Live from the Twin Cities, it's the Twin Cities Hit Show.
Hump day! Huh? Anybody?
It's hump day.
Let's get this hit show started.
Wow. Hey, feel this. Is this my blood pressure?
Is this our thing now this week? Just to,
yeah,
going late every day?
Yeah, it's kind of fun.
You know what? I really feel like we should just be more accepting of the flow. It's fine. It's a beautiful day. It's not as hot as it was yesterday.
God hates this show.
No, he does not. Stop blaming it on God.
God does not want this show to go
and
on.
And if God hates this show, it is not my fault. I am not taking... God loves me. Yeah, I got to think. We're all fine.
God thinks I'm pretty cool. Yeah. We're reestablishing our relationship.
Exactly.
Boundaries, I think, is the key with God. Boundaries.
Yeah, well, maybe on. I don't know. Today,
happy Wednesday, gentlemen. Yes.
What is the forecast today? It was.
I thought it was going to be sunny 80s. And 70, like
yeah,
78.
70s. Yeah, I think you're right.
Really?
Yeah, so beautiful.
Yeah.
Why are you wearing a sweatshirt?
Well, I don't know. It was. Yeah, I don't know.
I like that answer, though. That's a very
we
fair and reasonable
so
answer.
High. Can we bring
you saying that you don't know why? I think that's a beautiful answer.
What did we get up to yesterday? 119?
Something like that.
Yeah, my thermometer said 103 in the truck, and that was ugly.
It was funny. We had the Twin City, or not, this is the Twin City situation. We had the Twins Tuesday out at Floyd's, where on the first 90-degree day, they give away, it's free beer.
How did that work
all
out for you?
All the kegs are free. Well, we showed up... you know, just set up, and the guy and the bartender's like, "Hey, welcome to the 89.5 degree day."
Semantics, I like that. There's rules.
But then we started to see a whole crew of waiters and security at the door, and then suddenly it's 90.
Yeah, okay, yeah, so that makes sense.
Yeah,
it was good.
Hey, it's the Twin Cities Hit Show.
It is. I'm Rusty Gatenby.
I'm Chuck Gollum.
I'm Miss Shannon.
And some stuff to talk about on the show today. Good timing with our guest, Chuck, who we have.
Yeah.
He looks official.
He looks. You know, you can tell he's a cop.
How's that?
Haircut. Yeah. He's got that haircut. No, he's wearing a
uniform.
He's
very handsome and shiny.
He's wearing a uniform.
Yes, he does.
Nice.
Who is our guest, Chuck?
Yeah. Police Chief Rick Mathwig of the Roseville Police Department. Yeah, you're live, by the way. And since you're sitting here, you might as well take advantage of it. Getting close to that mic, and you are live. On the air, Rick Mathwig. Hi, Rick.
Great to be here. Thanks for the invite. Appreciate it.
How long have you been an officer?
Since January 1989.
89. So is the current climate different in your history? There's a lot of police stuff happening on national news.
Yeah, it definitely has changed a whole lot since 1989. You are correct. I think the biggest thing is the 24-hour news cycle and everything that's going on. That's a huge change.
Cell phones, getting the all
even having
the there.
Body cams and things like on that a lot of the officers have to wear now. I mean, that's the fact that technology is so much a part of your daily job now. And so, I mean, for the public and for the police officers, just there's always somebody watching you now.
Yeah, there is. I think when Chuck started in Roseville, you know, a couple decades ago, we had two radios and a pen.
Jeez.
We had one radio, Rick.
Oh, sorry. And then, you know, all your all your conversations were on the radio. You had to write everything down, and now we're changing into like our fourth generation laptops and body cameras and digital mics and things like that. So it's a big change.
Well, it was a cell phone that in McKinney, Texas, is the latest controversy, and they didn't. That officer didn't waste time. He's already resigned. Here's from CBS.
Expect to hear today from the lawyer of a Texas police officer who resigned yesterday over his actions at a pool party. Cell phone video captured the officer pinning a black teenage girl to the ground last week. He also pulled out his gun. Vicente Arenas is outside the police station in McKinney, Texas, where some say that this incident was racially charged. Vicente, good morning.
Good morning. There were death threats and calls for his resignation for this police officer here. Now the department is trying to figure out if excessive force was used and if criminal charges should be filed.
McKinney Police Chief Greg Conley described Corporal Eric Casebolt's behavior during last Friday's confrontation as out of control.
The actions of Casebolt, as seen on the video of the disturbance at the community pool, are indefensible.
According to CBS station KTVT, the 41-year-old's voluntary resignation was just one sentence long. I hereby resign from my commission with McKinney Police Department.
Were you surprised by the statement of the chief of police?
No, not necessarily surprised based on, I've only seen a few snippets of the video, but based on what I saw, it'd be very difficult to defend that as a chief. And even given the officer the benefit of the doubt, it's very difficult to defend the uses of force and what he did in that short snippet of a video.
See, and I was kind of, well, I wasn't kind of, I was defending the officer yesterday because it looked like two fairly good-sized young men were behind him and made it, what appeared to be a lunge at him.
Yeah, you're right, but why did he interact physically with a female all right by himself? So once you introduce yourself into that as an officer, you've already changed the dynamics of the situation.
Did you happen to see John Stewart's comment on it the night after?
No, sorry.
They show sound up from the home video, and the officer is yelling, "Get your ass on the ground!" And the female is already seated. And she goes, and he's like, "I don't know how deeper her ass can get off the ground."
I mean, I think that especially since we do have such a heightened sense of fear on both sides, from the police officer side and from just the public right now, you just kind of feel like it's your job, and I'm sorry to put all the pressure on the cops, but it's your job to calm a situation sometimes like that, especially if you're dealing with youth who I just don't think it's fair to have an expectation that they're going to be reasonable individuals. In this one, it's like nothing with his actions did anything that you could see to calm the situation. It seems like he just added more fuel to the fire that was already, you know, in a ready to take a blaze.
You know, I talked about this yesterday. I was talking on my ass because I hadn't seen the video yet, and I did watch part of the video later, and I actually listened to our broadcast yesterday. It was a good podcast.
It was.
Yeah, good choice.
I know. So
just a tad late, as usual. Yeah,
and so I was talking a little out of my ass, as I said. But the one thing I did say reflects what the chief says, and that's that he inserted himself into a situation which was tactically unsound.
Okay.
And that's the only thing I knew, having not watched this video yesterday. And that's bound to escalate things. He didn't put himself in a situation where he's surrounded by a bunch of teenagers, and his uses of force options were extremely limited, and he had to go pretty much to deadly force. Because you pull out a baton and take one guy out in the knee, 14 of them are going to kill you.
Right.
So you should know better. And there are some Supreme Court decisions saying that bad tactics don't justify bad outcomes. And really, that's what this came down to.
And I do feel for him because he was clearly outnumbered. I understand it's a situation where you want to make sure that you're safe and you're just trying to do your job. But part of your job is also being the voice of reason around unreasonable people.
Mm-hmm. Right. We get paid to be emotionally detached from a situation.
Right.
That's what our training really, really emphasizes, is don't get emotionally involved. And that's some of the complaints we get from people on the street, is your officers appear to be, you know, flat and robotic. Well, that's part of the process of being flat and robotic, is to be detached.
Right.
That's what we have to do.
Right. I carried that through into my, you know, I was a cop for 20 years, and I've remained flat and robotic my entire life. So
I think that's probably you got the job.
That's just good training.
I would go with idiotic.
I'm retired.
But then, obviously, being loud and aggressive is a card that has to be played as well.
Yes, it does, when it's necessary, because people do pay attention to loud noises, and that's authoritarian voice. Well, most of the time, except for Chuck. But authoritarian voices do attract attention, and that's kind of the officer presence that we teach cops when they're brand new.
Yeah, which offends a lot of people in the community, and certain elements of the community get really offended by, like you said, that kind of robotic demeanor. And he was, you know, just mean. No, he was detached.
He was doing his job.
Yeah,
you know.
And so you see these videos of everyone's walking, a cop breaking down, hugging a kid or whatever, and those are neat because cops are humans, and it is counterintuitive to act like that all the time. And you do that for 25 years, it does carry into your personal life and your interactions with other people, and it's hard to detach yourself. So there's a lot of dynamics.
Well, as long as we have you here, sir. I know you got great things happening in Roseville that you probably want to talk about, and we'll do that. But your opinion on the pedal pub situation.
Oh, I forgot to warn you.
Yeah, no, I
those
saw.
Those were off-duty officers.
Yeah, I'm trying to, and I know the chief down
it
there.
It was a Vill, but not a Rose. Yeah. It was right. a Burns.
So when you say you know the chief down there, did you like text him like, ha-ha, glad it's not me?
No, no, one day when I see him in person, I might do that.
Okay.
I see him at the neighborhood park. I mean, okay. he lives right near
do
me, and he's a great guy.
Squirt him with a squirt gun. Do
no.
not do that.
Yeah, no, no. He's pretty calm, cool, and collected for a little guy.
Yeah. So, yeah. He's calm, cool, and collected, I'll agree with. Yeah, I'm just glad it wasn't a Roseville because it's just a hard thing to defend. It was a, I'm not saying they did anything wrong, but would a John Q. citizen do the same thing? And do you know it's water coming at you? And as soon as you know it's water, do you really need to act? I'm not saying anything wrong. I'm just saying, you know, what would the average John Q. citizen do versus an off-duty cop? And there's
right.
quite a difference in the five or six guys that did it. I probably had no idea they were doing that to cops.
Right.
right.
Oh, yeah. No,
of course not,
they
yeah.
were very immature and idiotic as well. The people throwing the balloons and squirting squirt guns.
Oh, yeah. We're friends with some of those people, Chuck and I. We're, yeah. They are dumb all the time.
Yeah. As John Q. public, I just would have went, really, guys? Really? Come on.
But I know some guys that would have gotten off the pedal pub and punched
me in
the
face. Said, I'm going to break your arm?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, but I think that's out
they
of
might
line.
Not have been. They might not have been able to do it. But I know a couple of guys that are aggressive enough. We have those friends, and they're not even cops. It's just if you come at them, now they're going to try and fight you. Yeah. That's how fights start in bars all the time.
Well,
what do you expect?
I think those guys are idiots.
Okay.
And also with that, you know, I know Roseville cops, most likely Burnsville too, when the RNC came through town in 2008, officers had urine-filled balloons thrown at them.
Good point.
So
good
if
point.
They had that training a few years ago, that's going to be in the memory bank. So
that
you don't
would,
know.
Yeah. That would piss me off.
Yeah. Is it also a matter of
that
what
was a
Chuck
urine
said?
Joke.
I see what you did there, Rusty. So also back to what Chuck was saying, though, is it so much, you know, is it that those off-duty police officers, they're so in that role so much of their life that having an expectation that they're now suddenly not going to snap into that as a reflex mechanism, is that a little unreasonable?
No, it's not okay. Because just me driving down here today, whether I was uniform or not, I would still have my reference of when I am a cop. I'd look around the corners.
Right.
Yep. When I came up the stairs, even in uniform or not, I'd peek around the corner first. I do that all the time.
Okay.
In my personal life, I carry things in my left hand, which is my not my weapon hand.
Okay.
Even when I'm going to the baseball game carrying a bag, it's in my left hand. So some of those things you can't deprogram.
Gotcha.
I'm so non-copish anymore. I forgot the call signs for Bloomington.
Okay.
I mean, that's so weird. But on the other hand, I do the same stuff. I still index when I'm doing things. I still keep my left, my gun hand free, my right hand. That did suck. But I have to sit with my facing the door of any establishment. That kind of stuff just does not leave you. It's in your wiring at some point.
Donuts?
Yeah, still eat those with a reckless abandon.
So Roseville doesn't really make the news. Things seem fine up there as far as the police department goes.
Yeah, we do every so often. we just like the other suburbs and especially the two bigger cities to share the spotlight.
You are all blessed right. with a town that makes like the best lived in cities and the populace never moves like awards all the time. Like
really?
the ratings for Roseville, Minnesota are always amongst the highest of people move here, they stay here, they're you know, the way that they're invested in the community, they have the longest standing citizenship or something like that, based upon a lot of the cities that are here in the Twin Cities. Ooh. So Roseville is like super awesome anyway.
I got to jump in here just to name our sponsor. And that was brought to you by the city of Roseville. Roseville, a great place to live. Follow us on Twitter. Please continue.
Yeah, I think you're spot on with that. There's a lot of second and third generation Roseville people that bought their parents' home.
Right.
Or they bought the house down the block. And I don't find that in other suburbs. I didn't find that where I grew up in outstate Minnesota at all.
Right.
So there's a lot of people that do stay for generations and generations at a time.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get into it?
Roseville offered me a job first.
I remember the day they used to, their very first day on the job. I honestly remember that. I was a young dog catcher. And Rick showed up, and I remember saying, who's this young kid who's going to be way senior to me for the rest of my life?
Yeah, I actually backed into law enforcement because I didn't like sociology. I love sociology, but I hated chemistry, biology, the math sciences, things like that. So I just checked out sociology and went there. But Roseville offered me the job first. Bloomington was background on me, and they came through second, so I took the job. And it's a wonderful city, a wonderful department. The great thing about Roseville, for being a street cop, the only suburb that borders on both inner cities.
Okay.
And we have a lot of crime that happens in both cities. If you're a cop, you like to interdict in crime. As a chief, I like not to have it, but hey, that's what goes on with the territory.
Right.
But as a street cop, it works out wonderfully with both inner cities a rock throw away.
Nice.
Yeah, so I'm going to start with the basics. A lot of people don't know. What does a police chief do?
not much to put bad guys in jail.
Okay.
Most of my job is, I'm not a working chief. A working chief is like a smaller agency that goes to respond to 911 calls.
Sure.
If I get to a call for service, it's a big darn deal.
Okay.
Yeah. And usually I'm sitting behind a desk, emails, go to meetings, read letters, things like that.
Work on policy.
Yeah, policies. Okay. Interact with counsel and other
yell at people.
Yeah, every so often I have to authoritative voice, but I like not to do that very often at all.
How long have you been a chief?
5 years, just a little over 5 years this June. So I worked my way up from officer to sergeant to detective to lieutenant to captain to acting chief and chief, and it's worked out wonderfully. We just swore in a new officer last week and then a sergeant, and I said the best, most fun I had was a street cop, and the best gig I had was a street supervisor.
Nice.
Because you could go out in Roseville and make traffic stops and shake hands, kiss babies, and put bad guys in jail, things like that. And also affect change in your crew. Worked wonderfully.
Very
and
cool.
the more I get detached from the street, the more difference it makes in my personality. And I would rather, you know, if I could go back in time and get paid what I get paid now, make the decisions I make now, but still be a street boss, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah. I mean, you have one of the hardest jobs ever, and I'm not saying this just to kiss your ass, because there are a lot of police chiefs I frankly just don't like, but
I'm sure it's vice versa.
Yeah, oh, trust
Rusty,
me.
Will you please you stop no playing that? Every yeah. time you play that, you just make me look around like there's a problem.
No. I can attest for some of Chuck's supervisors who aren't big fans of him. Not me, but others.
Oh, no. I carry that in my next department. I don't know if you knew that. But no, and I like the chief in Bloomington a great deal. But the... It's a tough job because you have to answer to the city council. You're not half. I mean, there's so many segments of that job. You're a politician. You're a budgeting specialist. You're a disciplinarian. You have to interact with the union and the attorneys. There's so much to that job that is so removed from what got you into police work. And I remember, like you said, I mean, I was a sergeant for the last 12 years of my career. It was the greatest job and the worst job ever.
Mm-hmm.
But you get to do everything. And once you take one step up from that position of sergeant, you lose it all. You're now an administrator.
Yeah, it does become difficult. What I found is just communication is the key. Like with the unions, what I try and do is meet with them every couple of months just across the table at the local Perkins for coffee.
Right.
We're not talking about contract negotiations. We're talking about money. We're not talking about discipline. We're talking about what's the burr under your saddle, what's pissing cops off, and what's not working out well, and we can talk. And that really does help that dynamic. I think it's worked out wonderfully with council members and city managers. You just have to be open with them and talk with them and try to educate and do as much as you can with that.
When you see stories that are make the news, like in McKinney, Texas, is that cause to say, guys, let's just have a refresher meeting so we don't make the news like they are in McKinney?
Yeah, we talk about that in supervisor meetings, and especially I just had a meeting yesterday with some social workers and teachers, and talking about dynamic changes in law enforcement, and I was talking about the Cleveland incident and
right.
the alleged sweeping changes in the Cleveland Police Department. One of the sweeping changes they're going to make is they can't pistol whip people anymore.
Aww.
As a cop.
That's my favorite thing to do.
You've got to be nuts if you're allowing that to happen. Because in Minnesota, if you hit anybody in the head with a hard device, whether it's a flashlight or a gun or anything like that, that's deadly force. So in Cleveland, you could do that up until recently. That's astronomically nuts.
Remind me to tell you my pistol whipping story. No, I'm not kidding. I have a great pistol whipping story.
What's the statute limit? The 3-year statute limit?
It wasn't me doing the pistol whipping this time.
This time.
Cleveland, by the way, has a horrible crime rate, right?
I believe so.
It's a very violent town.
I rode along in that city. It was hilarious. Yeah. Did it ride along with the
hilarious?
It was, yeah, seriously. It's a whole different style of policing. It's like, I mean, what you have here is an image of a well-pressed police chief, and most police chiefs pull this off, but that's what all the cops in Roseville look like. You go to New York or Cleveland, these guys are wearing white socks, their shirts unbuttoned like 3 buttons. And seriously, they look like they just rolled out of bed, and their attitude follows. My ride-along in Cleveland was hilarious. It's a busy, busy, busy city.
Right.
I did a ride-along. I get in the car. These guys, Mr. Gallup, nice to meet you. Okay, we get in the car, we start driving. They're not saying a word. And they go, so what do you do for them? I said, I'm a cop. Oh, shit, man. We thought you were some regular citizen. All of a sudden, they were good old boys. We're driving along. We make it about 2 blocks, and some kid flips them off. They get out of the car. They jack him up. They arrest him. And our entire shift was spent arresting this kid. 8-hour shift. Processing this kid who flipped us off 2 minutes into my ride-along, and that was it. That was my shift in Cleveland.
Jeez.
Yeah. I mean, you could never get away with that in Roseville when you have 6 cars on the street and you need everybody. You can't spend 8 hours processing some juvenile for an arrest you can't technically make.
Do you think that maybe that because of the situation that they're put in and them not being so community-driven, that it just causes more problems than it solves? Maybe the community isn't – that's why the community isn't on their side and doesn't trust them.
Yeah, exactly, because the cops are running from call to call, only dealing with drunks and people that, that don't like life to begin with.
Right.
If that's all you're dealing with, then you can lose touch with the actual reality of who your citizens are.
Okay. I do like the fact that we do things like this. I used to be part of the Minneapolis Police Activities League on their board of directors, and I really appreciated the fact that those police officers would get involved with the kids in the community and the families and do what they can to actually go, you know what, we are all here together to try and foster that that symbiotic relationship. I thought it was good for the police officer as well to actually put a face on the people in the community and not go, hey, if I see, you know, a little minority kid that's walking by, he's not all, you know, automatically a potential criminal or a perp or something like that. He's just some kid that's walking up the street. So I thought it was good for both sides.
Yeah, exactly. We've got a cop we just hired that spent probably half his childhood in Sacramento, California, in the projects there. And he said why he became a cop is because the positive contacts that Sacramento cops had with him. When he was sitting around, the cops would come, his friends would run, but he'd sit there and stay and talk to the cops and have positive interactions with them. That's one of the reasons he's a cop now in Roseville, because of those Sacramento cops. I can thank them for their what they did for him back in the 90s.
Very cool.
Yeah, that is cool. You know, my experience as a police officer, what I saw was parents that would socialize their kids to hate the police. Don't talk to him. Cover up their eyes, cover up their ears when the cops are walking by. Don't talk to him. Don't talk to him. And instead of that attitude where, hey, if you ever get in trouble, see that guy in the uniform, go talk to him. He will always help you. See that guy in the uniform, don't talk to him. He's bad. He's bad. He's just looking at you.
Yeah. Well, maybe they had one bad.
Everywhere.
Maybe they had one bad experience. Yeah. It's the same thing, you know, because I've had mediocre experiences sometimes with police officers, and I've never really done anything. You know, I just remember when I used to live in Eden Prairie that I would get pulled over because I was driving at a time that people get pulled over, you know, kind of thing. Yeah. And I just acknowledged that and went, fair enough. You probably think that I'm driving here because you think that I am dating a Viking. I am not. And it kind of, I knew I was just getting profiled. So I'm like, you know, little black girl driving home at 12:30 at night. They don't know I have a show or that I'm not driving home from a bar or something like that. And once they saw that my address actually said Eden Prairie, they usually, because they, I felt like they barely made it to the car. Like they go, can I see you? Yeah, here.
Yeah.
And I'd sit there and they'd go, do you know why you pulled me over? Nope. And I would just sit there and he would walk away like six steps, it seems like, and walk back, hand me my things and just go away. So I'm like, what else do you have to do other than pull people like me over? And I'm driving around in Eden Prairie.
My ex-brother-in-law lived over north. Mm-hmm. The black dude named Gordy Kirksey, who you may or may not know. He's kind of in our circle, but great guy. And he got pulled over all the time. He goes, you know what? And I can't. Well, actually, I can't kind of mimic Gordy because this is how he talks. He's like, I'm just going to get pulled over. I'm a black guy driving over north at 2 in the morning, and that's just what's going to happen. I get it.
Yeah.
I don't like it, but I get it.
So I just I just deal, you know, kind of thing.
Everyone
I mean, not
gets
everybody's
pulled over.
Like me. Yeah. No, everybody does not get pulled
at
over.
At 2 in the morning?
Some people animals? Get pulled more often, more often not.
So well, that's probably here's dumb, naive Wayzata boy. Don't you have to have a reason to pull someone over?
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, it's, but reason can be in quotes, in my opinion. I gotta think.
Well, a broken taillight or a swerve. Or
I know in Roseville, with all the activity we have in town, and there's like 100,000 people in, like right now in Roseville, it's very difficult for you to drive probably a mile without some sort of traffic infraction. I probably had 4 or 5 just in my 15-minute commute here, whether it's 1 mile over the speed limit or bumping the fog line. Or not signaling my turn quite perfectly, that sort of thing. There's a lot of reasons. In what happens is the perceptions are reality. Mm-hmm. If you think a cop is stopping you because you're African American, then that's going to be your reality.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, the cop may have stopped you and not known you were African American and only stopped you because your blinker didn't work for that period of time. Who knows? But perceptions are reality.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's very well put. That's very well put. And I think I told you, I know, maybe it was Courtney I talked to, our old host, about a time I stopped a black guy at 3 in the morning for driving through parking lots of businesses. You know, I'd stop anyone at that time. I didn't know what the race was when I pulled the guy over. I was FTOing a guy, and the guy gets up to my trainee gets up to the car, and he goes, can I see your license? You're to stop me because I'm black, blah, blah, blah. He goes, we're done here. And my trainee storms off. I go, no. We're not done here. We're going to talk this through. And the guy and I got out and roadside talked for like 15 minutes. I let him sit in my police car, see my view of what his car was with and without my spotlight on. He goes, okay, I get it. And I go, ultimately.
And then you pistol whipped him. That is a good story. That's a great story.
No, I took the next step. I peed on him.
Gosh.
But I think the communication piece.
Why do we go there so early in the morning?
If Eden Prairie cop had actually told you why and walked you through it for 35 seconds, your opinion might have changed.
Exactly, because I really felt like it was arbitrary. Yeah. And I just made myself okay with the arbitrary nature of being pulled over and said, okay, here's probably what it is. But the fact that he didn't say, oh, well, even if he said, I thought you crossed the line or I thought you swerved, if there was some reason other than just, What's up? All right. Hey, bye.
And that's what we're, that's what we're trying to do in Roseville. Before I ever heard of Ferguson, Missouri, mm-hmm. was when you leave an area, when you leave a traffic stop, when you leave an incident, tell the people why you're there. Take 35 seconds to say why we're here. And no one's in custody or this person's in custody. Here's why I stopped you. Mm-hmm. Here's why you were detained. And leave them with a feeling of neutrality.
Right. Yeah.
And then 10 years from now, you're probably not going to feel like that. Hopefully,
yes.
with
Agreed.
Roseville. So
mm-hmm.
that the communication is always the piece.
To your discussion, Shannon, I wrote a paper for my master's degree, and I called it Profiling Good, Racial Profiling Bad. Mm-hmm. Because, frankly, race should fit into any good profiling. Profiling is simply good detective work, good police work, good TSA work. Profiling
right.
is part of that. If I see a black male in a crap car in a beautiful neighborhood, in a neighborhood that I know and police regularly, and I know that something about that is wrong, that should be part of my profile. By the same token, if I see a white guy in a business suit in North Minneapolis, and I work in North Minneapolis all the time, I know that he doesn't belong there at that time, should never be there. That should be part of my profile. Race is part of that. Now, if you use race alone, you're not profiling well.
Right.
But that should be part of it. It's part of the collective profile that you, as a police officer, knows that area well and polices on a regular day.
And profiling doesn't have to be a bad thing, though. I mean, we have whole TV shows that make it sound like if you're a profiler, you're like a super awesome superhero, days.
Help me to understand. I'm the guy who is wearing my best Men's Warehouse suit, and I'm walking mm-hmm. in North Minneapolis. What are you going to do, Chuck? What are you going to do to me?
Well, if I have a reason to stop you, and I know you don't belong there,
stop me.
And you're acting suspicious, part of the profile. I'm not just for that, but if you're sweating, if you, depending on how you're looking, what you have in your hands.
Last I checked, it's not illegal to sweat, Chuck.
Right. Well, you would know. But that's part of the profile. As I'm driving by you, and I know what belongs in that neighborhood and what doesn't, and I see you in your pressed three-piece suit in the middle of the day, and you're not carrying a Bible, and you're not looking for doors to knock on.
You're violating my freedom then, aren't you?
Not necessarily.
I haven't broken any laws.
If I drive by you and I profile you, you do nothing.
We don't know if you've broken any laws, and they talk to me all the time because they don't know if I've broken any law.
I guess it's not illegal to say hello.
But the biggest thing that Chuck has talked about is behaviors.
Correct.
What is odd in the neighborhood is the behavior. If this house is vacant for this time because they know the family's on vacation and somebody's milling about, then the behavior is what's really important.
By the same token, and DUI enforcement was a huge part of my career, and I ran the traffic unit in Bloomington for a while, and that's what we did. But profiling, that's really what DUI enforcement is. It's profiling. You're out late at night. You're swerving over the line. You do that two or three times. That's a 45% chance, based on NHTSA stats, that you are drunk. If your high beams are on, there's a 30% chance that you're drunk. And so on. And that's part of the profile. Same thing. Now, I'm profiling. I'm going, all right, white male coming out of a bar, 2 in the morning, swerving a little bit. Yeah, maybe he's reaching for his phone, but maybe he's drunk.
Right.
That kind of thing.
Well, the swerving, I see that. Yeah. But all right.
So, anyway. But
I think it's just as reasonable for you to profile a white male wandering mm-hmm. around in North Minneapolis as much as it would be if you saw a female standing around on a street corner in the middle of the night
right.
as well.
And that's
profiling. I think that's reasonable, kind of thing. It's like based upon a group of demographics, this is probably what this person is doing. I can go up and ask them some questions on either side.
We are all profiling every moment of our daily life. The obvious example is you're walking down the street and four black males with hoods are walking toward you, and maybe there's just a way you could very comfortably for yourself. And for
I'm
them,
thinking barbershop quartet.
Yes, of course you are. Hmm. But that's profiling. And it might be profiling, I'm trying to think of another example, but I mean just something you do in daily life. Like, all right, I'm following this car, I'm pulling to the gas station, we're both going to SA, and I'm in a hurry, but this car in front of me is going to pull forward. It looks like they're going to go to the gas pump, so I'm going to go around them and get to this other gas pump first. You're profiling. That's part of it. I mean, you're doing behavior detection. You're indexing in your brain how you're going to react to that situation, and that's what you're doing. That's what cops do every day.
So if we have the young demographic listening, or anyone, and I mean any demographic, but specifically some of the younger people, like the crowd that was at that Texas pool party, and they're faced with a situation where they feel their rights are being violated. What should they? How should they? I think I know what I would do, but you, officer or chief, give the advice. What do you do?
The first course of action is at the scene once things calm down. Is ask to talk to a supervisor. And I think this cop was the corporal or a sergeant down there in Texas. That doesn't help out a whole lot. But who's on the scene that's the most senior officer that I can talk to once things are calmed down? If that doesn't work, then an hour or two later, call the dispatch and say, hey, I'd like to have a supervisor call me. If that doesn't work, if they don't call you back or you don't like what they have to say, then the next day follow up with an email or a phone call to somebody's ranking supervisor. With Roseville, we have 48 cops. There's only a couple levels of supervision. Eventually it gets to me within a day or two, and that's great that it happens like that. Just make the telephone conversation, and a lot of times people just know why they were thrown down or why they were handcuffed. Oftentimes that takes care of the situation. They feel better because they know why it happened. But if that doesn't work, file a complaint. There's a lot of people out there who rightly feel that police don't investigate their own cases, because we have Cleveland's, we have Ferguson's, we have places like that. But I know with Roseville, we take every complaint, every concern seriously, whether it's email or phone call or anonymous or not, we'll look at it. And if they don't like that, they can talk to the city managers, to the city council, they can file a civil suit. They can do a lot of things. They can talk to a judge if they were arrested for something. They can talk to the judge and say, this was horrible because I was only stopped because I was African American or detained because I was Latino. They can talk about that, and the judge can throw it out, and the judge can give it back to us and say, hey, Roseville, you screwed up. Here's what we want you to look at. Judges do speak very plainly at times in court. You'd be surprised at how plainly those, at least the Ramsey County judges, can speak.
From a safety issue, do you think that it's, because I just remember what the cops were saying in both situations, where it's like, get on the ground. Should I just sit down? Don't try to run. Don't engage. I'm just going to sit here Indian style.
Yeah, one
until
girl
you
was
work your stuff
sitting
out.
On the ground. Right. That was not here. Enough for okay. that officer.
Well, yeah. And Rick brings up a point. I want to highlight that when you said that. Some of the first words out of his mouth is, when things calm down, make your call. Follow directions in the first place.
Because as cops, when we put someone in arrest, we want them down on the lowest level that we can. Because we're in a dynamic situation, a position of power over top of someone. So if they do try and roll, they do try and fight, if I'm on top, have a level on top of you, then I can control you much better. So if you're sitting down just with your hands out, that's a good spot to start. I don't know if it helped in Texas or not, but 99% of the time it's going to help just by stopping and listening. Mm-hmm. Some of the situations where there's too many people talking and not enough people listening, I'm sure sometimes it happens here.
Oh, yes, every day.
You can't listen to what the person's
saying.
What
have saying.
You heard? I just get concerned with the way that we have such a level of easy escalation. Like, for instance, I look about this, I think about the future. Like, I have a 7-year-old and he has autism. And so I understand that we should try and stop and listen and understand situations. But I know that there are a bunch of people who just don't have the ability, once they get in a situation like that, to de-escalate on their own. So, I mean, what have they done from a standpoint from people that might have some mental challenges or something like that? How do they provide that sort of training for police officers and things going forward?
I know there's some that's given the initial training when they come out of the academy, like the Chuck talked about with skills and the initial training for junior cops. In Roseville, every 3 years, we do mental health training, dealing mm-hmm. with people with mental health and all those autism spectrum disease, how we can communicate better. There's just a lot of patience that's involved. If you have the time that you have the patience with people, a lot of good things happen. Sometimes you have to get in front of the rocket and stop the gun, stop the knife, stop the fight. But that's only a few seconds of the 5-minute interaction. So probably 90% of the interaction can be a calm conversation or hand gestures. My first traffic stop ever in my career in January of 1989, 35W South, coming into Minneapolis out of Roseville, just north of the old bridge before it fell, and it was with a guy who was deaf.
Okay.
And it was 8 o'clock at night in January, so it was cold, and it was, snow was blowing and traffic was going by. You couldn't believe it. So my very first traffic stop was the cop. Was done via my pad. And I talked about paper, back and forth. So you work through that. So it worked out, and I'm still here.
Yeah.
Who was your FTO? I'm just curious.
Palermo.
Oh, jeez. Palermo's a good guy and a very patient guy.
Okay.
Some of my funniest stories come with Mike Palermo. That guy was just a fun field training officer.
What was your pistol whip story? You never officially told
okay,
us.
Okay, I won't name names, but I was working for a certain department where there's a big mall. Not Roseville, another big mall.
I know.
Oh, Harmar.
Go on.
And we had this newspaper guy who drove around at 3 a.m. and we'd see this guy everywhere. He pulls up. Hey, just so you know, someone's breaking in the Burger King at 98th and Nicollet. So we should go over there. So we go over there, and sure enough, we get there. First car in the scene, another former Roseville guy. He knows what I'm talking about. And sure enough, these four burglars are in the process of breaking in, and they see the first police car arrive, and they take off running. So we've got four people running four different directions, the entire working shift of Bloomington headed over there, but people running. It's like herding cats.
Okay.
Well, I'm I see one guy just about to take a guy into custody. We're across the lot of Kennedy High School, and from a distance, I'm on foot running up to him, and I see him about to handcuff the guy, and all of a sudden a gunshot goes off. I go, what was that? And I'm thinking, I'm yelling, hey, are you okay? So the cop is standing over the kid who's kneeling. There's no answer, and I know things are going to break because there's no way a gunshot goes off and someone doesn't say something. And I realized what happened. The cop pistol whipped the kid, and the gun went off.
Oh.
And it was out of pure anger. You can't do that. But so, sure enough, someone yells, shots fired. And I didn't know what to say. Oh, my God. Everyone's going to think there's shooting going on. I'm like, and normally you can, code four. There's no, I don't want people to think that. I didn't even know what to say. I said, we're okay on the shots. We're fine. Well, yeah, sure enough, the pistol went off. And, of course, creative report writing, that whole thing went away. But,
That was not a funny story at all.
Wait, now, please tell me that you're joking about the creative report filing.
Well, you know, I'm telling you my perception of what happened. The officer had a different perception of what happened, and I was, of course, a parking lot away.
Oh, geez.
And just to be clear, that's the first I've heard of it was right now. So.
Yeah.
Good. Good. Because if there was some cover-up and we broke it on this podcast and be like, you know what, I don't think I wanted to be a part of that.
My perception. My perception.
Well, are there things happening in Roseville that you want us to know about?
Yeah, I just brought some reference points because you never know what's going to happen, especially if anybody calls, just to refresh my memory. One of the things we've been doing for the last couple of years is just the positive engagements. It's nothing that needs to be official program or funded by the U.S. government through a grant or something like that. It's just if you have 5 minutes and you're driving down the road, you see one of our cops a couple of years ago, just as an example, saw a couple guys at the bus stop. And just there was no bus coming, so they probably got 5 minutes to wait for the bus or 10 minutes or something like that. Just stopped out and said, "Hey, I'm officer, you know, whomever. Anything going on?" You talked about interactions. At first, they were very apprehensive because the cop is like 6'4" or so.
Right.
Walked up and they were very apprehensive, but after they left, he exchanged business cards and high fives, and off they went. Going to Super America and buying a a Slurpee or something like wrong business.
An icy.
And you see somebody in front of you in line for paying. Hey, how's it going? Hey, the weather's this, or how the Twins doing, that sort of thing. Vikings, whatever it happened to be, and just have a positive engagement, just to show that we're not the uniform. We're the person behind the uniform. That's been working out gangbusters. And what I firmly believe, if we can blanket the United States with those sorts of positive connections, I think we'll be in a better place in 2 years than we are right now.
Absolutely important. And yeah, I'm sure some of the videos that come out of cops doing some great things. That one that broke my heart. I don't know, San Diego area. I think the cop buys a kid a meal, leaves, and gets killed.
Oh.
But it's just a horrible story. But I mean, I love what's happening in these interactions where, you know, I got an extra dollar, I'm going to help out. That buys such goodwill in the community.
Yeah, and then there was one YouTube video of the cop lip syncing to some hip hop sort of deal.
Taylor Swift.
Yeah, Taylor Swift. Yeah. And it worked out wonderfully. We got video across the country of a cop just kicking a soccer ball around with a kid for 4 or 5 minutes.
Or buying a kid's shoes in New York. I saw that video that went out as well. So that one was really cool.
Yeah, and the same cop that I talked about stopping by the bus stop, we had a theft at the Target store in Roseville, and found out it was a young mother, probably 18 years old, might have been, she was very much down on her luck, and when he did, she was arrested for theft, and all the items she stole were for her kid. We still got to prosecute. We diverted her off into a diversion program where it's non-criminal, where they're talking about mental health and trying to help her out, that sort of thing. The cop went back on his own dime, bought the things that she had stolen, and got them to her because we know where she lived.
Wow.
And then the diversion people, so it was maybe 40, 50 bucks out of his own pocket, which is wonderful, all stuff for the kid. Then the people we diverted it off did a fundraiser for her and bought her stuff, a couch and a table and a chair for her apartment in St. Paul. So those small things. And, you know, no one from Ferguson, Missouri has heard that Roseville does that, and there's probably a lot of things that are happening across the country that people don't know about that are good, positive things. We only see the snippets of a Texas deal.
From an outsider, it seems like they're making a point where a cop just gets burnt out and people need to be replaced.
Yeah, that's common. I think it's very common in the narcotics industry. Once you're undercover cops, with Roseville, we limited to 3 years. Sub agencies, you can be there for a couple dozen years. You're just asking for trouble because once you get involved in that too much, you see the underbelly of the society of the United States. You got to get out of that because you're asked anybody, even the Pope, could be tempted in something like that.
Right.
Yeah. Agreed.
The Pope's working undercover. That's awesome.
Surprise! It's Francis.
How many young ladies are on the force?
Oh, yeah, I do headcount. Probably about 8 or 9 with Roseville.
That's a pretty good percentage. That's 20% almost.
Yeah, has that changed since you started, too? The number of females becoming...
When I started in 1989, we had one female sergeant at that officer at that time. She eventually became chief. Now we have probably 8 or 9, and just have one in training, and a couple of our part-time people are female officers too, or part-time dog catchers and things like that. That Chuck started his career at works out really wonderfully. So
I never really left the dog catcher. the whole thing about me being a cop and a sergeant lies.
You just stayed a dog catcher.
Yeah, because women are minority in law enforcement too. I think across the country it's like 10% or something like that. Yeah. So that's something we need to, as we're trying to be more broad of the people that are in law enforcement. We can't forget about women too, because they're also minority in law enforcement, look at life differently than men do.
And you talk about Burnsville. We talked with the Pedal Pub. Their goal has been for many years people with at least a bachelor's degree, master's as much as possible, and high diversity in terms of females.
Right.
They were shooting for 50%. I don't know what they were at, but they're easily 40% of their departments.
Wait, you do have to have a college degree?
You have to in general. And Chief,
yeah, there's it's a couple. It's changed over the last 20 years. At a minimum, it's going to take a high school student 2 years to become a cop. Now, 2 years of an AS degree through probably 10 or 12 junior colleges and state colleges in Minnesota that have a law enforcement degree as an associate's degree, or you can go as a GED or a high school student from Minnesota, then go work in like South Dakota or Texas or Missouri, where you only have to have a 12th grade education, work there for 3 years, then take a reciprocity test, come back to Minnesota. Or you can have a BS degree in English or zoology or whoever it happens to be, and then take a test and come back in. So we can't just instantly change in Minnesota to reflect the demographics or women or anything like that. It's going to take at least 2 years to make those changes. And go to Burnsville. We lost the cop to Burnsville because they offered her a job before I could.
Mm-hmm.
They beat us by about like a month, and I think she's doing gangbusters down there.
Yeah.
Right.
So it's very common for us, especially last year. We had two Asian American officer candidates and a female officer candidate. All three of them got picked up by different agencies about a month before I could scoop them up.
Wow. Nice.
Because we're all fighting for the same candidates. So when we have,
and it's
we
a smaller pool of candidates, I'm sure.
Yeah,
you know, that's
is.
Just numbers. That's not a matter if you're not looking or you're not interested in it. There's just less there. Yeah. So, of course, I'm glad that they are in high demand, though. That's very cool to know.
Yeah, and departments need to take intentional steps to find candidates in their high school when they're 14, 15 years old that are interested, and keep them close and recruit and make them feel wonderful about your department and interact and keep them, and then you can get them.
And it'd be great for us to put as much effort into trying to recruit people into public service, things like that, as much as we do athletes. We're so like, oh, well, hey, we know this guy. He's going to grow up and play baseball or basketball or football. It's like, no, other people, I would like you to go into the high schools and recruit as well and have internships and ride-alongs and things like that.
And over the last few years, I felt like a college coach recruiting a football player or baseball player in my program.
Yep.
I feel like that. You've got to make the connections. You've got to send them letters. You've got to make email contacts and things like that to keep good candidates close to you, because you need them for your football team better than Notre Dame does.
Yeah.
And it's not a quick process to hire a cop. I mean, you have to go through the degree. You have to graduate from college, typically, move on to skills, which takes a while to get into. That's, in effect, the police academy. Then you have to take the post-test, which is the licensing test. Then you have to get an offer from a department, a physical examination. Sometimes a testing involves working out. And you have to be backgrounded. So it's a very slow process. When he talks about losing people because they were a month behind, it could take several months to get hired.
Yeah, as quick as we do it, it takes at least 4 or 5 months to get that process done.
Okay.
In the meantime, Minneapolis has one or two academies. St. Paul has one or two academies and other places like that. So it's difficult with that process.
Is there an age restriction? Do you ever have guys who are like, they're a teacher or a real estate agent, and then in their 30s go, I want to be a cop?
Yeah, we've had a few of those. They bring in wonderful life experiences. They bring in other perspectives and other paradigms with the industries that are different. It works out wonderfully. Well, we're always, even if someone is 21 years old and they have a lot of life experience, you can tell that when you interview them. And someone is 30 or 40 that comes in, they do it wonderfully. What we look for in this industry is you want to get as many, maybe 20 years out of a person. So if they come in at 40, come in. I'm almost 50 now, and I would not want to go out there and work the street.
Fair enough.
I would not want to do that. Because it's tough on the body, it's tough on everything. It's a younger person's game out in the street out there. So you think about that. You can't restrict by age. That's protected. But you have to have that consideration when people interview and how you score and how you work with people and how you recruit. We'll take teachers that have four or five years of experience. Mm-hmm. Works out wonderfully because they do speak to people differently than someone who just fell up the turnip truck.
One of my sergeant partners that we worked very closely together, it was 63 when he retired at Bloomington. And it was just hilarious. I was like, go, will you go? Or back in the day, I won't mention names, but we had a sergeant in Roseville who had gotten a bad injury to his back, and he had pain control. He had this some sort of modern thing hanging off his gun belt. No, that's sorry. Oh, that's our sign. We need a commercial.
Do we?
Yeah.
All right. I was having fun chatting.
Well, stick around after the break. We chat some more.
All right. We got some other things we can talk about. Who knows? We're having fun. Let's just take a quick break.
Yeah, okay. I do.
Yeah, I'll really be right back.
The Twin Cities Hit Show. We'll be right back. Don't let your computer problems drive you mad. We are MacMen, Minnesota's premier tech consultants and problem solvers for Macs, mobile devices, troubleshooting, training, and much more. No more dragging your computer all over town because we come to you. We love making house calls to your home or small business. MacMen, call 612-345-8005. The Alive and Social Network is alive and growing. From the best in sports, music, movies, and beer, Alive and Social is what all the cool kids click on. Featuring characters like Radio Rebel Jeff DeBay, Star Tribune pundit Jim Suhan Unfiltered, and television veteran and handsome man Rusty Gatenby. You can also taste the Minnesota Pubcast with Jason and Molly. Join the band with Live Band Karaoke Night from legendary O'Gara's in St. Paul and the Live Music Showcase from Shamrocks. Yes, Alive and Social Network does indeed rock and roll. The Jeff DeBay Show, Jim Suhan Unfiltered, the Rusty Gatenby Review, the Minnesota Pubcast with Jason and Molly, Live Band Karaoke, and Shamrocks Live Music Showcase. Join the fun. Be alive and social with the Alive and Social Network.
The Rusty Gatenby Review is the entertaining show about entertainment from movies, music, and more. Award-winning TV guy Rusty Gatenby and his review is the podcast with the biggest cast in entertainment, part of the Alive and Social Network. You can get that Minnesota connection to Hollywood and beyond any time of the day or night simply by clicking on the RustyGatenbyReview.com. That's the RustyGatenbyReview.com, part of the Alive and Social Network.
You're listening to the Twin Cities Hit Show.
Say it three times fast. We just dare you.
All right. It's your Roseville Hit Show.
Yes. This episode brought to you by the city of Roseville.
One of the happiest cities to live in.
This is also brought to you by the Chart House Restaurant, where we have our Thursday afternoon deck show.
We're scrambling now.
Yeah, we're scrambling.
Miss Shannon's blowing us off.
I am not blowing you off. I was previously engaged. That's it. You know, I'm not going to be sitting around.
So busy. So remember, 5 o'clock at the Chart House, we'll be live on their deck with our live show. Hopefully an exciting guest. If not, you get to see Rusty. I mean, who would
be? You guys get along fine. That would be a fantastic show, even if I was unable to make it. You guys will be, I mean, hashtag positivity. Rusty and Chuck are two amazing individuals. They'll have a great opportunity for you to come down and hang out with
us at
the Chart House.
Dead ahead.
No, don't forget.
Why do I have more confidence in the two of you than you have in yourself?
I have plenty of confidence. Just Rusty, it's a Debbie Downer here.
I have newsreels of the Hindenburg in my brain right now.
He's reliving his helicopter crash. Mayday, mayday. Hey, also, remember, if you drink too much when you're at the Chart House, you can always call Blue and White Taxi. They have great taxi service, and they're very available in the suburb of Lakeville, Minnesota.
And they're sponsors of the deck show.
They are, and the Third Street Brewery with their delicious beers. And I'm told they should have taps up and running, not this week, for sure next week.
Outstanding.
Yeah, so you will see me very drunk next Thursday.
Because you know you got to ride.
I tend to get very violent and slobbery and pukey.
You do not. Yeah. Stop giving people unrealistic expectations. Yeah, I know you won't do anything fun like that.
I think I am previously engaged in other
Welcome to the... The Chuck talking to himself.
Chuck
Gallup show.
Gallup shit show.
I live this every moment of every day. It's really nothing different.
So what have we learned here today?
That we can't move to Roseville because nobody will leave the city. So there's no room for us to relocate to Roseville because it's too fabulous.
Because we have Roseville Police Chief Rick Mathwick sitting right here.
If you get pulled over speeding, is there one thing you can say that will definitely get you a ticket?
What might not allow you to not get a ticket is be honest.
Yeah.
Back years ago when I was still a real cop, which I'm not anymore, is stop a guy for like 15 or 18 over who said the truth. I was doing this, I was doing that, I'm an idiot. And, okay, I don't want to kick you in the gut anymore. Well, here's a warning stop for you. See you later. Slow down. If you honestly think someone's going to slow down, you don't have to give them a ticket.
Right.
It's like $130 or so.
Yeah.
It's very, very high. And as long as I have the mic, I can tell you, the city of Roseville only gets about $20 out of that $130 ticket. The rest of it goes to the state to help balance the budget from a different administration.
So do you say that to go, well, it's not like we're out there on a quota. We're not pulling you over on purpose just so that Roseville can make more money.
Yeah, and in my role, how many times a year I hear people say, hey, you could balance the budget if you sit on County Road B and write tickets at this location. It's $20 a ticket. And if we have to offer us to go to court, odds are they're on time off. So they get paid 3 hours overtime.
Yeah.
So we're paying about $150 for a cop to show up, get $20 back. It ain't a moneymaker.
So it's not fun for you. Giving somebody a speeding ticket.
Yeah, exactly. And we probably do three times as many warning stops as we do as tickets. Some cities, some of the suburban departments do the opposite on that, or at least they had been over the last couple of years. They may be changing that attitude right now because what's it get? The city of Roseville doesn't need to depend on that income. It sits in a pocket somewhere, and it's not necessary. I think that was.
Is there bragging rights though in the break room? I got 10 today.
You know, I used to brag about pulling over the most unique vehicle. I pulled over an MTC bus. And tagged the driver and made everyone wait. I pulled over an armored car, and they did not want to open the
speeding?
Door. Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, okay. And tell you, getting them to open an armored car, to give them the ticket, that's a tough one.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, wow.
Was Patrick Swayze and Keanu Reeves driving?
Everyone was wearing a scream mask. I was a little alarmed.
The only thing I haven't been able to tell you is a war story about Chuck. If you, can I
say
that?
Yes, I would love to.
I figured you guys would ask me that. I have it because I'm not a very good storyteller, so I worked this out.
Well, neither is he. And listen,
he's got a Venn diagram right there.
Yeah, this was back when Chuck was working in Roseville. We worked together on the east side of Roseville. So either he was a backup to me or I was backup to him. We get called to this house that I go by even today, probably once or twice a week. On a domestic or a 911 hang up or something like that. One way or another, we had to force the door open because there was somebody inside who was probably being assaulted. So we peek in the window, nobody's there, knock on the door, nobody yell real loud, and nobody's there. So Chuck says he's going to kick the door. Okay, cool, go ahead. So Chuck was a little bit smaller than he is now, and well, so was I. And he kicks, nothing. Kicks, nothing.
And I could just see him sitting there like waiting to kick. I'm going to kick it now. I'm ready to kick the door now.
And he keeps kicking it. Then he stops and he puts his hand on his knees, pulls up his sock. And I'm not lying. Pulls up his sock and kicks it again. Nothing happens. Guy opens up the door and says, what? Can we come in? And we did.
Oh,
I don't know if you remember that.
I don't remember that. But that sounds so Chuck. There's no doubt that happened.
You kicking a door just sounds like a loud, aggressive knock. That's great.
I think he actually pushed me aside so he could kick it.
Of course I did. Of course I did.
Dude,
I got this.
Go ahead.
I got this.
Anything else?
No, that's the one story.
That's
I can remember
a good one.
On it. The rest of it worked out, I think, pretty well.
To your question, Rusty, people that say, how do you get out of it? When I was a motorcycle cop, I would give one warning a day. Because my job, I figured, was to write tickets. So everyone got a ticket, one warning a day, someone who was honest and someone who was nice. But as a person who gets stopped once in a while, what I do is I just throw it out the card. I'm like, look, you just stopped me because I'm Jewish? And that works. That works. Because they know what they're in for.
What was the most afraid you've been while on duty?
Probably the one time that I let out a gasp like, oh, where I thought I was dead, literally.
Oh.
Was just going to an alarm at a business at night. And by myself, for some reason, the other cop wasn't there. You're searching, you're checking windows, checking doors, and it's dark, and you don't use your flashlight because you want the darkness as your friend.
Is that why you do that? Because I see that on TV, and it always seems so illogical that they don't just flip on every light when they go inside.
And we'll step into gopher holes. We'll step off curbs and hurt our knees and ankles, and the HR people and don't like that very much. But, hey, we're going to use darkness as our friend.
Okay.
So walking up to the last door, the man door, as it's called, and I, for some reason, must have been talking my radio, and all of a sudden the door opened out to me, and a guy came out with something silver in his hand.
Okay.
And my hand, I had my gun out, but cheek down at my knee, And I went, oh, because I thought I was dead.
Yeah.
It was a cell phone.
Oh, thank goodness.
And it's how different for both of us would our life be if I had had a different display or had not been, you know, tactically trained to keep your gun down or your finger off the trigger, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And I let out a gasp. I thought I was dead.
Yep. Wow. Yep.
So, I, you know, there's another time that back in the 80s, I was searching a car, and for whatever reason, narcotics or something like that, and searched the whole car, and I had this two brass fittings on the end of something in the middle there, and there were clips on it, like a spring device. I kept clicking it. I looked at it. I clicked it. I took it apart. It was a double-barrel shotgun with brass fittings. So when you click that, if the pressure was high enough, the firing pin would shoot.
Oh.
So I almost shot mine. It was loaded.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
And it never fired. It's like, oh, my gosh, how different life could be. It's like that was the first time I had seen that. So basically someone would hold it, and they could shoot side to side.
Yep. Oh, jeez.
Probably about an 8-inch or 10-inch device total with the brass fitting.
That's what you don't, you just wouldn't expect. You just run up on people that have, like, James Bond-style weapons and things like that, just do stuff.
I do believe his offense,
Exactly.
Yeah, because he couldn't control it by shooting anyway. It'd probably torque his hand so much, it would be damaged to his wrist by trying to shoot it. So I can't even remember what happened on that, but that's what I remember out of that case.
Wow. Chuck? Yeah.
Oh.
I suppose you almost killed yourself on a motorcycle.
No, I've had a few.
So that's pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah. No, there's that whole motorcycle where I spent 3 weeks in the hospital. That was great. Yeah.
And a personal story I've never ridden on a real motorcycle. My dad was an insurance agent for 30 years. Do you think his kid ever rode a motorcycle?
You're like,
no way.
You're like, I need a car.
So when cops asked me about a Roseville thing for Roseville, it ain't happened. I just go back to what my dad said to me like 30-some years in a row. You're not riding a motorcycle. You're not buying one. So I never have.
Bloomington got rid of theirs, right? I mean, they kept their one bike for a while, and then they went down to zero.
Well, that seems... Yeah. I don't know. I always think that it's silly that we have motorcycle cops here in Minnesota. It just seems impractical to have a fleet of motorcycles when you can't use it 9 months out of the year.
Chicks dig the boots. One story.
Where are the boots then?
I have them. You want to see them, baby?
Are you wearing them?
Right now.
No. I want you to loan them to somebody else.
Okay.
Okay.
Fine.
So,
oh,
all right.
Nice. So I was chasing after a guy, an old school cop of mine who went on to L.A. and then St. Paul, and I know Rick knows what I'm talking about, always taught me. He goes, look, if you have a good partner and you're running after someone, here's what you do. They know that you don't mean this, but if you're running after someone, you say, he's got a gun, shoot him. And they're either going to run faster or they're going to stop. Well, in my experience, no one ever stopped.
No.
So, sure enough, I get dispatched to a car theft in progress at Bennigan's, the old Bennigan's, and I walk up on foot to sneak up on these guys and catch them breaking the car. Well, they'd already stolen the car by the time I got there. I was right there when the call went out. But they had already started the car. They see me in uniform, and instead of driving away, which would have been the smart thing because I was on foot at that point, they stop. And they throw the car in park, and they take off running. Now I'm running after three people.
Jeez.
And I rely on my personal training and say, he's got a gun. Shoot him. The only problem is he had a gun, and he panicked, and he pulled the gun out, and he threw it, and the gun went off as I'm running after him.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, and to this day, I swear he was shooting at me. And the witnesses and the report all said he reached over his shoulder and was shooting at me. Didn't stop me from chasing him. We ended up catching him. I go, I think he had a gun, and I think a gunshot went off. And sure enough, we went back and found the gun in the magazine. Mm-hmm. Ballistics testing showed that he threw the gun, and that's what set the gun off. But that was probably the most terrified I've ever been.
Jeez.
Don't. And then I never, ever said, he's got a gun, shoot him. Ever again in any foot chase.
Right.
Yeah.
Now you're just giving him ideas,
neither.
It sounds like.
Me neither.
Do you see DWI improving, or has that just been a constant since 1989?
It's been a constant. What we're seeing now is more chronic DWI offenders, where the same people get arrested because they do have true alcoholism and don't have it treated.
So they're chronic.
Yeah, they're chronic, and it's 3, 4, five, six by the time they're done. The highest blood alcohol content that I've seen on a call was like a 0.39 or 4.0 or something like that. And that guy was probably in his 50s, and he probably operates every day at a 0.10 or 0.15. He just happened to clink it up at that time. So it's more of the chronic ones. It's still out there. I forget there's like 13,000 every DWI arrests every year in Minnesota, something like that. You think we run out of people, but we're not. We're not going to.
Yeah, yeah. We you may not have heard the episode, but we had someone from DWI Court coming in and talking about treating and targeting these particularly chronic DUI offenders. It's quite a problem.
Well, what's the biggest problem you guys face in Roseville?
Theft.
Really?
Yep. Okay.
If you haven't heard, Rosedale is in Roseville. As long as we're promoting the city of Rollsville, Rollsdale is the second to the amount of foot traffic to the Mall of America. And to compete with the Mall of America, the St. Thomas studied it for several years in a row. During the Christmas shopping season, more Minnesota customers come to Rollsdale than do the Mall of America.
Correct.
Iowa, North Dakota goes to Mall of America. Yeah, Minnesota folks come to
Rollsdale. I did not know that.
So we balloon up to 100 and some thousand people a day. There's a lot of cars to steal from. Most of our more serious crimes are called the Part 1 crimes, which is your homicides, your theft, your burglary, your kidnapping, things like that. Our highest Part 1 crime in the city is actually in Rollsdale, and that's mostly all to do with theft.
Okay.
Shoplifters and car break-ins and things like that. So everybody that comes into the burbs drives. Nobody walks in the burbs. There's no sidewalks. That's pretty cool. We get a lot of activity through the bus lines that bring people in for that do a lot of shopping and also do a fair amount of theft at the same time. So that's what I talk about, the two inner cities, but theft is the huge thing. I think in every suburb, especially in someone that has a Dale, like Minnetonka and Edina, Burnsville, and Mall of America, that sort of thing, it's theft.
I must be oblivious because I just walk through the malls and I don't see a lot of police activity. But
yeah, you don't, because it actually only happens in 3 or 4 minutes that we're gone.
Yeah. Grab them, they go.
Yeah, it's almost years ago I went to discussions about in Israel and the bombings over there, and the guy that talked that what they try to do when there's a bombing in Israel. Homicide bombing is to try to get the place to natural within a couple hours. In Minnesota, United States, we'd be locked down for months at a time. But there, they try to get back to normal. Same thing here is get the suburb back to normal so the real operation can take effect.
So I have a suggestion that I think you should add to your Roseville Police Department PR team. So here's what I think you should do is that there's all those stories about the selfie cop from New York. Have you seen him? Mm-hmm. Okay, so he's this guy, and he's the New York City Sheriff. He's a deputy named Miguel Pimentel, and he's been taking, like, these sexy selfies and back to, a police officer. He has all these tattoos and all these other things, and so he's got a really big buzz. So I think that we should find a Roseville police officer. That'd be good for that, and he'll start taking selfies, and we'll get super famous for that, and then I think that'll be good for your guys. It's a community action project.
We'll take it under advisement.
Here we go. I'll show you a picture of him. Chief.
He's got the look.
See? Do you have somebody like that on your...
What movie was that with the
Jake
look?
Gyllenhaal?
We could
do that.
We got some cops who could pull that up.
You got some selfie pose cops that we can do that? I'll be happy to assist them. My selfie game is tight. I'll give them some lessons on the selfies.
Everyone I'm thinking about is married too, so.
Doesn't matter. They don't have, it's just alluding to the fantasy. That's what it is.
What's your favorite police movie, cop movie?
It's a little bit of a law enforcement. My favorite movie ever is Raising Arizona.
Okay.
And it's got a little bit of a bank robber thing. And
Coen Brothers,
like that.
Minnesota
kids. Yeah, absolutely wonderful. But
timely with the prison escape as well.
Yeah, exactly. I don't watch too much of that anymore, especially with two kids and growing up. I've seen a lot of Barney stuff over the years and that. So I don't really have any. I don't watch any of that stuff any longer.
Yeah, what is it? End of Watch with Jake Gyllenhaal.
Okay.
Did you see that?
Yeah, it's a tough one. Not realistic at all, but on the other hand,
it's not
the
realistic.
The day-to-day stuff is very well done, but the way the whole plot came together.
Never mind.
But I mean, riding in a police car, they've got the vibrations that happen, the computer rattling, the way the partners interact.
That just made some muscle memory of yours go, oh, yeah, I remember what that felt like.
It's absolutely hits my senses, but the plot itself was so ridiculous. I saw the movie twice.
Yeah, I haven't seen it, but that's realistic in a squad car. Everything rattles. Everything moves around and shakes around and driving corners, and it just drives you nuts.
Yeah.
Well, I think we've killed an hour.
Oh, we've killed an hour, all right. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for coming in. This was really enlightening.
Well, thanks. I appreciate the invitation. I'm always looking out to get the message out there. It's wonderful I can do it here.
How could people get a hold of you if they want to tweet you or email you, ask you questions?
You can just email me. The best way, we do have a Twitter account. I just will forward things. I have my own Twitter account years ago that I just monitor us. I'll check us on Twitter a couple times a day.
Yeah.
Check us on YouTube a couple times a week just to see who's talking about us and what they're doing.
But now we know what you'll do with your Twitter account to do the Roseville hottie selfie police.
It's just rick.mathwig@cityofrollsville.com. There you go.
Cool. That's easy to find. Yeah.
All right. Well, we're going to end the show today. I thought Tim Curry was honored with a Lifetime Tony Award yesterday in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And Chuck had pointed out last night, he's like, Tim Curry had a stroke. Yeah. And I guess I didn't know he had a stroke, but years ago. Yeah. So he does not look good.
No. No, he is definitely not pulling off the pantyhose anymore. Tim Curry of Rocky Horror.
Yeah, exactly. Fame,
compared to his Rocky Horror picture. But he was also nominated for a Tony Award for Spam-a-Lot. So apropos to with all the bad stuff happening in the world. Yes, Chuck?
I got to point something out before we go off.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Do it.
Mercy's May, one of our guests. I just want to take a moment to talk about Mercy's. It did not do that yesterday. Mercy's film director filmed a movie at my house, was very seriously injured in a car crash up in Hugo, Minnesota last Tuesday.
Yes.
Not Mercy's fault. Sober. We always ask that question, don't we? 3 o'clock
Roll
in the afternoon.
Stuck in the car.
Yes. He went into it. He had avoided a box that fell off a truck 2 vehicles ahead of him. His car rolled over, rolled down into a drainage ditch. Mercy was unconscious and trapped upside down and airlifted. There's a GoFundMe right now because Mercy's lost a bunch of his movie equipment. And right now we're trying to locate a couple of the hard drives with the movie he's been putting together. Those are missing. And Mercy's, I talked to him on the phone, he is messed up with a brain injury right now. He'll be fine, but there's going to be a long road to recovery. There's a GoFundMe account for Mercy's May if you type
So we
it
should
in.
Put that on all of our pages just so people can find it easily.
Yeah, it is actually, I put it up as soon as I saw it about last week on the Twin Cities Hit Show page. But please think of Mercy's May. He's not, you know, he's going to be fine. It's going to be a long road. He's in a lot of pain. He's got a lot of people that support him, and he needs money. So I will put all that up on our page.
Yeah, he was a great dude. Yeah. Or is a good dude.
Yeah. Yeah.
We should maybe rerun his show, too, then.
Yeah, that'd be a great idea.
Relink his show so people can get to know him again. Well, here is a bit of Tim Curry. Congratulations on a Lifetime Achievement Award. This is him singing from the Monty Python musical Spam-a-Lot. And it's something we should all do. We should all get on the bright side of life.
Always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath. Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show. Keep on laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. Always look on the bright side of life.